the parable about who the wicked husbandman. And this, well, do we read it? Okay, just for us to get, let's see. All right. Well, we have to read it so that we can get it, so that it won't be that he said, I say. Okay, Matthew 21, 33, please. To... Okay, let's just read. All right, to 43. Bro, Josiah, well, anyway, Bro, Josiah, you want to read that, please?
Here, another parable. A certain householder which planted a vineyard. Hedge it around about, and dig a wine press in it, and build a tower, and let it out to husbandmen, and went into a far country. And when the time of the fruit drew near, he sent his servants to the husbandmen, and they might receive the fruit of it. And the husbandmen took his servants, and beat one, and killed another, and stoned another. Again, he sent other servants more than the first, and they did unto them likewise. But last of all, he sent unto them his son, saying, they will reverence my son. But when the husbandmen saw the son, they said among themselves, this is the heir. Come, let us kill him, and let us seize on his inheritance. And they caught him, and cast him out of the vineyard, and slew him. When the Lord therefore of the vineyard cometh, what will he do unto the husbandmen? They said unto him, he will miserably destroy those wicked men, and will let out his vineyard unto the husbandmen, which shall render him fruit in their season. Jesus said unto them, did ye ever read in the scriptures, the stone which builders rejected, the same is become the head of the corner? This is the Lord's doing, and it is marvelous in our eyes.
Please continue to 45, please, when you read. Continue.
Therefore say I unto you, the kingdom of God shall be taken from you, and given to a nation, bringing forth the fruits thereof. And whosoever shall fall on this stone shall be broken, but on whosoever he shall fall, it will grind him to powder. And when the chief priests and Pharisees had heard his parables,
amen. So we know the parable, what the parable is saying, but it means there's a hidden message in here. The husbandman or husbandmen are the contractors who were hired to take care of the vineyard. And in this case, these are the Pharisees, because in the last verse we read, what did they say? It says, when they heard it, and they said, they knew that he was talking about them, about the Pharisees. And, you know, so that's a very, very simple parable to understand. And the Pharisees, were they not righteous? Were they not holy? Were they not people who had all these good intentions? They were very, very religious. They could study. I understand that. What did the Lord Jesus Christ say about them? They like to they make their tithe. Their crops. They pay tithe on everything. A little thing they pay tithe. They were so particular that they were very, very religious and so. But then, and they knew about the commandment, "Thou shalt not kill." So how can a Christian? Let's use Pharisees as being Christian. How could they, who say they are Christians, and yet be plotting to kill? You know, they're supposed to be, let's use the word quote, they should be to be righteous people who were interested in God's word, right? But they were all against Christ. So we can see here that While on the face level, the Lord Jesus Christ is talking about himself, because when they said, oh, God is saying, the whole thing has to do with God sending all the prophets, all those from the beginning, sending them to one Israel. And we should also remember that when Prophet Moses was telling all the Israelites in Exodus, in Numbers, in Leviticus, and Deuteronomy, what did they say? He said, remember, don't forget. And what did they say? We will. As for us, we will obey. We won't forget. But didn't they forget? They forget the obedience. They forgot so many things. And so we see here that they had gone on the edge to the extent they knew. God said, don't kill. Thou shalt not kill. They knew it. But now they were plotting to kill the Lord Jesus Christ, because they were supposed to be righteous, but they had allowed the devil. They had given in. They were not vigilant. They were not serious. They were not genuine in their obedience to God's word. And so what happened? They had become angry. And what does anger do? Sometimes it's a small little anger, small little hatred, small little, I'm angry at this thing, I'm not happy, I'm this thing. And then what does the devil do? Oh, you are angry, oh, that's good. Then the devil will multiply the anger and multiply, and then there becomes hatred. And then it becomes, we remember Simon, whatever we want to call his name. Who was he? Simon. He was also somebody who was a sorcerer. By the way, I hope maybe just before we don't forget. Witchcraft is the same thing as sorcerer. Witchcraft has three levels. One part is called what? Witchcraft, the first one. The second part is called divination. The third part is called sorcery. Balaam practiced what? Divination, which means casting spells on people. Right? We all know it's in the Bible, it's there. And what did Balak do? Balak said, oh, I've heard about some people. They are coming from the turnpike. Please, they are coming. Don't let them come. I fear them. So come and do what? Come and curse them for me. Because I know that anybody you curse is cursed. But Balak didn't know that Jeshurun, it's also the same name for Jacob or Israel. God had said to Abraham, anybody who blesses you will be blessed. Anybody who curses you is cursed. And so God had given Father Abraham the everlasting blessing. So anybody, everybody, his line. So Abraham, Isaac, Israel, because Jacob was the name, he was the crafty person. So let's give him the right name, Israel. So God had said that all the line of Father Abraham, they are blessed. So Balak said, oh, come and curse those people on that route. And then he said, because I know that you are a professional, and I'll give you $1 million, just curse them for me. And Balaam said, these people, I think they are tough cookie. I don't think I can crack them. He said, oh no. Okay, I'll give you 15 million. No. Because God has, so he was known for that. That's, let's just cut it. And we don't need to go into Numbers 20. It's there. And then go to the New Testament. Sorcery. What is sorcery? Sorcery is what? Again, witchcraft, divination, sorcery. These are all part of witchcraft, which is part of rebellion, which is part of, it's all using human effort. And that effort is provided, or the power is given by the devil. And so sorcery is, Simon asks, what did he do? He was a great man. He was known, He was very good. And in doing what? In deceiving, in deception. But when he saw Philip was under God's Holy Spirit and performing all the miracles and doing all the work. And then he was doing a great job for God. And then what happened? Simon, when he saw Philip, said, "Wow, you are doing all this. That's great. Oh, well, wow." He was wondering, "Wow, Philip, see what Philip is doing. Wow." Okay, let's see what it says. Acts 8. In Acts 8, 9 to 25, we encounter Simon, the sorcerer, who bewitched the people of Samaria and was filled with what? We'll come to that later. But there was a certain man called Simon who previously what? Practiced sorcery in the city and astonished the people of Samaria, claiming that he was someone great, to whom they all gave heed, and from the least to the greatest, and they said, "This man, he's the great power of God," and they heeded him and all that. So I'll jump quickly. Then verse 11 says, or 12, "But when the people in Samaria, when they believed Philip, as he preached the things concerning the kingdom of God and the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, both men and women were baptized. Then who? Simon himself also believed. And when he was baptized, he continued with Philip and was amazed seeing the miracles and signs which were done." You know, so not to go into all the details, but he, Simon, what did he do before? He had this thing, lust of money, and he had sorcery. He was deep in it. And he said, "Well, he's been baptized. Oh, I'm a Christian. I'm following Philip." But that was not genuine. So that's why when we say people must be regenerated before they go into the baptismal water, it means that you have to repent. You have to genuinely repent. If that is not there, then it means you are not truly, born again. So what did he do? Then he was following him then. Says, So then he saw, this power that you guys have in, healing people, can I also have some? Can you share me the secret? Can you tell me how you do them? And he saw Peter. He says, give me the power, this power also, that anyone on whom I lay hands on may receive the Holy Spirit. But what did Peter say? Peter said to him, "Your money perish with you, because you thought that the gift of God could be purchased with money. You have neither." Can look at what Peter is saying. This man, he's just been baptized. He's a Christian, right? But Peter's sending him to hell. But Peter said to him, "Your money perish with you, because you thought that the gift of God could be purchased with money. You have neither part nor portion in this matter, for your heart is not right in the sight of God. Repent, therefore." Again, somebody who has been baptized, how can he, So that's why we say that repentance is not a one-day process. Repentance is every day. "Repent, therefore, of this your wickedness, and pray God, if perhaps the thought of your heart may be forgiven you. For I see that you are poisoned by bitterness and bound by iniquity." That's a heavy stuff to say to somebody who is a Christian. Nowadays, we don't say, "Oh, he's a Christian. No, you're going to hell."